They were not satisfied with just getting to the round of 16. They wanted more. Same as a quarter final, same as a semi. We're here to win the final.
It should have been impossible for us to win.
They're 3-1 in front, and that might be enough to see off the Wanderers.
We're not playing on an even playing field in terms of their league salary cap. This is teams with unlimited budgets.
At halftime, the players basically throwing up.
Well, this is one of those nights when you can say you were there.
That doesn't make sense, that 8 days after you get beaten by Adelaide City, you go and beat the biggest club in Asia.
Could have killed himself, could have killed everyone on the bus, but then a bus hit us behind.
When I saw it walk past that post, I remember that feeling was, one of the best I've had in football.
We were called the small club yesterday. Today we are the biggest in Asia.
Before the tournament, what was your target?
For the ACL. Get through the group.
And they are the history makers.
They've done it.
The Western Sydney Wanderers, champions of Asia.
It was a first for Australian football. No A-League team had conquered the Asian continent. Incredibly, impossibly, it happened just 2.5 years after the Wanderers were born.
Firstly, I'm honoured and privileged. I feel privileged to have been given this opportunity. Certainly, it's a great challenge, but it's obviously one that I know I can handle, and I look forward to exciting times ahead.
They're an instant hit, winning the A-League Premier's Plate in Season 1, qualifying them for the Champions League. Asia's elite, and they were drawn in a tough group. Japanese giants Kawasaki Frontale, Chinese Cup winners Guizhou Renhe, and 2012 winners Ulsan Hyundai of Korea.
It was expected to be very tough for Guizhou to get out of the group, and impossible for us to get out of the group.
It's a bit of the unknown, but what we do know is that we're prepared for it. I think from the outside, everyone's telling us how grueling it will be, but as a group, we don't even speak about that. We only speak about how honoured we are to be in this competition.
Korean clubs very competitive in this competition. Four times winners of the Asian Champions League, Ulsan being the last 2 years ago. The Tigers, well, they are unbeaten in 12 Asian Champions League games. So it is a huge test tonight. Bridge lays it off for Ono, scoops it into the path of Santalab! Oh my word! What a start for the Wanderers in Asia! 41 seconds!
Yeah, I felt, once that goal went in, I felt really comfortable. Yeah, we've got a solid shot at this.
What we weren't prepared for was that the level of detail. Yeah, if you're 1 metre off your position where you should be, you will get punished.
You know, there was 3 mistakes from players that don't make mistakes.
That's what happens at that level, that you can make only a couple of mistakes, but you get punished for it.
They're 3-1 in front, and that might be enough to see off the Wanderers.
What was the mood like after it?
Yeah, very low. I remember it. It was our first game of the Champions League. We wanted to get off to a great start in front of a good crowd, and kind of went not towards plan.
You know, it's our first time here at this level, and you know, we learned some harsh lessons tonight.
I really just took from that game where I had to have a real outlook and overview of everything that we did to try and juggle the two competitions, which is not easy.
Now let's get the all-important team news. The Western Sydney Wanderers wonder how many changes Tony Popovic has made. Let's now get our team news with our match commentator for this evening, Simon Hill.
Quite a few changes made by Tony Popovic, not least in goal, where Jared Tyson replaces Ante Covic, who hasn't travelled. There are also debuts in defence for Daniel Mullen and Anthony Golek. Shannon Cole, we believe, will start on the left flank, with Labanot Haliti leading the line up front. Tommy Juric, Shinji Ono, Brendan Santalab and Adam Dapuzzo have all been left back in Australia.
How do we be successful in both competitions? You know, we will need the whole squad. So we need the whole squad to be physically prepared to be able to play at any moment. And that was a key for us.
I think he made that aware early on. We knew that was going to be the reality. You know, in the end, you can't question, you know, his motives and what he did to achieve wins in the Asian Champions League as well as A-League.
Yeah, we went to the game confident.
within our dressing room, and it was great to get this early goal, and maybe this settled the nerves.
And they've got a header on goal, and it's in the back of the net from Mark Bridge. What a start for Western Sydney.
We weren't really threatened too much. I mean, from what I can remember, it was quite comfortable. The longer the game went, the more space there was. The only, like, really disappointing thing from the game is that we didn't make a statement then and there and put a couple more goals away.
And there we go. It is all over. And Western Sydney Wanderers were comfortable victors. It finished Guizhou Renhe 0, Western Sydney Wanderers 1.
Their first points in Asia. Now to do it in front of their own fans. Next up was Kawasaki Frontale, home and away. First at Parramatta, where victory was a necessity to keep on track to get out of the group.
Just Kavita Abiu threads it through, and Juric on the turn. It falls for Haliti! They've got an early goal again! Western Sydney Wanderers.
Delighted with the result, of course, and it was tough. You know, sometimes you've got to ride your luck, and, you know, it's a valuable 3 points.
Now we go away against this opponent, Kawasaki, away from home, but we don't fear that game. We look forward to it. Yeah, Shinji will be starting, so, you know, I think that's great for him to be back in Japan and showcase himself playing for Western Sydney.
It's a deep delivery instead, and it's gone in. Lamina Haliti has scored again for Western Sydney. Kawasaki.
Space here for Oshima.
And he squeezed it in, Oshima. Disaster for Western Sydney. Delight for Kawasaki.
Four games down, 6 points won. Now for the crucial encounter. The return match in Korea against the side that taught the Wanderers a harsh lesson on night one, Ulsan Hyundai.
The Ulsan one was big for us because they came here and, you know, scored three against us. So my memory of the game is that we controlled the majority of it, and 2-0 was, at the very least, a fair result.
Cole. Bridge, free header. Mark Bridge has scored for Western Sydney.
Yeah, this probably in the group stages was overall our best performance. I think from start to finish, we dominated this game.
This goal, you remember it clearly?
Yeah, remember it clearly, and, you know, Santa coming on and getting the late one, which really sealed the victory. And, you know, it was a great moment for all the players.
Very important and very good performance as well. Like, I mean, obviously, you know, in terms of going through, it's a massive, massive result for us. People at home probably don't realise how brutal the trip over could have been. But the boys are so positive. You know, it's a good group to be a part of, and it's a good win tonight, good performance. Come say hi, Dad.
I don't know how we top that in terms of what we've seen so far this season.
No, by Central Coast winning tomorrow night, and then the whole three teams winning in the last match day, match day six.
Anything else?
And and then one of the three teams, yes, one of the three teams winning the competition.
Is it possible after what we've seen
tonight?
Yes, it
is. Mm. Yes, it is.
It's not that enjoyable playing in the Champions League.
Oh, wow!
That could have been so easily dig a hole, you know, lie in it and just say, you know, bugger it.
You know, I don't regret that decision.
Start for Melbourne victory.
And Central Coast have been ripped to shreds again.
And to be honest, playing in Asia, not that all enjoyable. People going down left, right and centre.
We went from having a great performance in China to having the worst performance ever.
Central Coast 0, Kawasaki 5.
Pohang Steelers defeating the Newcastle Jets by a thumping 6-0.
At this moment, I'll be leaving 7 players at home. And we'll only travel with 14 or 15.
You know, being involved and watching it, I can understand why people don't come and watch. It's not that enjoyable playing in the Champions League.
Maybe we're starting to really embrace this competition. We're starting to believe that we can actually get through. Yeah, we've won the tournament. So that's a real positive that we can compete. And although the resources will always be an issue, squad sizes will always be an issue, we've shown that anything's possible. And hopefully now we'll see more and more Australian teams get through the group stages.
Well, Tony, it's pretty simple tonight. All you need is 1 point to qualify for the last 16. It's a pretty good position to be in.
Yeah, an excellent position to be in for us. You know, after the first game, you probably wouldn't have thought this was possible, but it's in our hands. And, you know, we need to really take advantage of that here at home in front of our fans, and we need to get the result.
I mean, to be fair, they sent a weakened squad because they couldn't qualify. It was nice to show if you want to send a weakened side, they're going to get spanked.
Pass to two, but he brought it inside onto the right. The overhead kick, goal, Western Sydney. Fabulous goal, Shannon Cole. Well, that's a mistake seized upon. Lamino Haliti finishes it for Western Sydney Wanderers. Moy scores. The Wanderers stretch their lead. Cole in the corner. Xing Ping with a fist. Only breaks here for... Oh, no! Oh, wow!
You haven't got a goal. Good times, huh?
Yeah, great times.
Xing Ping has missed it completely, and Nikolai Topor-Stanley makes it five.
Oh, it was a little bit icing on the cake, you know, to get that one. It was a while between drinks for me, so, you know, I savoured it.
To in the end finish on top of the group is something special. You know, we're through the round of 16, which is fantastic, and now we've got to recover well and get ready for a big game on Saturday.
It was back to A-League duty, culminating in the grand final in Brisbane against the Roar. Then 3 days later, the Champions League knockout stages against Sanfrecce. They'd go to Japan with heavy hearts.
Here's Enrique, chance! Enrique! He's done it again! Is that the championship winner for Brisbane? There it is. Brisbane have won it. It's cruel on the Wanderers. They're beaten for the second year in a row in the grand final.
You know, tonight will be tough, but, you know, we wake up tomorrow, it's a new day. And, you know, we've got to get on a flight and participate in a, you know, prestigious tournament. And, you know, we're in the round of 16. So we play the J-League champions of the last 2 years. It's, you know, something special for our club to be at this stage. And, you know, we've got to get focused and do ourselves proud over there.
That was a tough 3 days because... Yeah, we played on a Sunday night in Brisbane. We got back to a hotel at the airport about midnight.
I had a meal together and reflected on, I guess, the A-League season.
That could have been so easily, you know, dig a hole, you know, lie in it and just say, you know, bugger it.
Yeah, it was a real somber, real quiet atmosphere. 4 hours later, they had to get up at 4:30 a.m. To get a flight to Hiroshima, and then you arrive less than 24 hours before the game in Hiroshima.
And I remember the boss talking to us over there, and you could tell, like, the poor guy looked like he hadn't slept since, you know, the lead up to the grand final. It was the first time where I'd seen him really flat. And he admitted that. He admitted how much he was hurting, but he said he owed it to us to be professional and to prepare for this game like he would every single other game, because it's a massive game. There's a massive chance for us to go from the biggest disappointment to one of the biggest achievements.
You managed against your former captain there in returning to your, yep, to your former club. What was that situation like?
It was great going back. You know, I had a great reception from the fans when I got off the bus. So I had some great memories there, some great friends, and yeah, and you're right, yeah, their coach was my captain when I got there, and yeah, it made it sweeter knocking him out.
Lyle had a good look at that, but allows play to continue, which Sanfrecce will be thankful for. Here's a chance. Ishihara scores for Sanfrecce Hiroshima. Defending to do here for the Wanderers. And a shot on the turn from Matsuda. It might break for Ishihara. Oh, that's really good.
Again, you know, he hardly touch a ball throughout the game, but there's that one half chance, you know, and that's, yeah, just a real classy finish from a really good player.
They've forced the turnover, the Wanderers. Here's Tommy Juric, down he goes, and it's a penalty. He's awarded the spot kick.
No, he hasn't.
Or has he?
He's hedging his bets. No one really knew.
Got a bit of luck there, maybe, do you reckon? Or
Possibly, but, you know, you get your luck, you know. He was positive to take him on, and yeah, that one might have gone possibly our way. But, you know, this was a big moment.
for us in terms of having a chance of, I believe, going through. And a 2-1, I felt it put us in a really good position knowing that the second leg's at home.
And then?
Yeah, it's late, really late on in the game, and it's a disappointing goal to concede.
Disaster for the Wanderers!
You know, I put my hand up. I was very frustrated with myself after that. There was a bit of traffic. Yeah, it wasn't a good feeling. And for me personally, because I had a part to play in it.
We put in a great effort. Some great finishes from them, but easy goals to concede, you know. Look, we've got next week to look forward to now. We've got the important away goal. So, you know, we get two on the home soil and go through.
The third goal, you know, makes you walk off a little disappointed, but I still recall in the change room, you know, it was very positive after the game.
They have to play on the weekend, they have to travel, and it's not easy for anyone to come to Parramatta. So it's still a very doable thing. So I remember trying to convince boys, get your heads up, it's a big week ahead, you know, we've got plenty of time to go back and recover. It's going to be a tough week for them. It was a very tough week for them.
In trouble, there was extra motivation. The second leg against Sanfrecce marked the end of an era. May is the time in Australia where players move on. A number of senior Wanderers were, like foreign stars Shinji Ono, Yusuf Hirsi and Jerome Pollens.
I've still got a lot of respect for all of them. You know, we're still in contact with most of the players. So, and I've always acknowledged those players. They've played a big part in us winning this trophy, you know. But, you know, we made a decision that what we felt was the next step forward for the club. And, you know, I don't regret that decision.
Hang on to your hats. This could be a special night in the AFC Champions League for Western Sydney Wanderers. The target is clear. A 2-0 win is the perfect outcome. Concede a goal, though, and the improbable may become the impossible. The margin for error is certainly wafer thin.
You know, the way we played at home in that game, I'd say that was one of our best performances in the whole Champions League.
Still Ishihara, and Ishihara does get the shot on target. It's the outswinger from Ono. Free header! That should be 1-0 Western Sydney.
Your goal. You were on there for about 3.5 seconds, weren't you?
I went on as left back. Their midfielders dropped quite far back, almost like fullbacks. So I thought, OK, I'll push on really high, and if the ball breaks, yeah, I'll be able to keep him in, you know, in around the area. And all of a sudden, I ended up, you know, 15 yards from goal, and the ball was on my chest. And didn't get much time to think, which is probably best, and just put my foot through the middle of it.
Shannon Cole! Off the bench, Shannon Cole has given Western Sydney the lifeline. Oh, no. Looking for Juric. He gets in front, makes a nuisance of himself.
Scenes. From when Santa scored and that last 5 minutes, adrenaline was through the roof. Everyone was so pumped. Everyone, you know, would have done anything, thrown their head in the way of a boot to make sure the result stayed that way. And after the game, it felt like we'd won something.
Well, this is one of those nights when you can say you were there. What a performance this was from the Wanderers. They've made some magic here at Parramatta. They are through to the last eight of the AFC Champions League.
After the game, the three players that you say thanks to, no longer there.
Yeah, they didn't just give a performance on the field, but emotionally they were definitely in this match. They knew a victory would put the club in the quarterfinals, but they would not be able to play in that. And that takes a strong character to be able to deal with that. And, you know, they'll always stay with me, that moment with those three players.
It should have been impossible for us to win.
They've lost it, Guangzhou Evergrande.
Could have killed himself, could have killed everyone on the bus.
At half-time, there were players basically throwing up.
When did you know or start to believe in yourself and maybe not tell other people that you could actually win it?
I think after the Guangzhou, after beating them.
They've done it! Unbelievable. The Western Sydney Wanderers through to the semi-finals against the odds.
Just to do it in pre-season was what made me believe that we could do it. You know, you're 6 weeks into your preparation, you've got so many new players, we're nowhere near match fit. And if you can beat them at that stage, then you start to really realise that as we hopefully get fitter along the way, we might be able to really do something special.
That special seemed impossible in the lead-up, when in the midst of pre-season, they were dumped out of the FFA Cup by part-timers Adelaide City.
We moved on straight after that game. The players have been very positive, very focused, and that game was pretty much the first 90 minutes for a lot of the players. So having got that under their belt, I know they'll go into the game full of confidence tomorrow.
This Champions League quarter-final tie presents one of the greatest challenges in the Wanderers' short history. In Guangzhou Evergrande, they faced the reigning Asian champions, Chinese Super League winners three times on the bounce, and a World Cup winning coach in Italian Marcello Lippi.
People don't, not that they should, you can't expect anyone to understand or appreciate, but it should have been impossible for us to win. I mean, I remember in the off-season writing on my hand, GZ, so that when I was at a family barbecue or doing something where I had a chance to pig out or it was time to party, I'd look down and I'd see GZ Guangzhou and remind myself, all right, you can enjoy your off-season, but there's something special waiting when you get back. So it didn't leave my mind the whole off-season. Yeah, the determination for me personally was, this is the biggest thing that I'm ever going to be a part of.
We don't go into it with fear, we go into it with excitement. You know, I think the whole country should be excited that, you know, an A-League side's in the quarterfinals.
The opponent and pre-season was tough enough. Another factor to make it mission impossible was the squad changeover. Gone, proven performers. Coming in, a handful of untested prospects.
We made a decision to make some changes. Some players decided to leave. Some were from our decision. That obviously hurts you in terms of the ACL, trying to bet in new players, and, you know, it doesn't help when a lot of them come actually after the deadline of the players that you have to announce for the quarterfinals and so forth. So our new players weren't even eligible, a lot of them, to play in that.
So a massive challenge this is for the Wanderers. Their pre-season form has been patchy. By contrast, Guangzhou have lost just one in their last 10 in their domestic competition. Hasn't been properly cleared by the Wanderers. Dreadful defending by the Wanderers. Chance here for Evergrande.
Look at that space in midfield now for Western Sydney.
That's the pace, Robbie, that they are putting on the ball now. Shifting it so much quicker. It's stretching Guangzhou. Chance here for the Wanderers. It's gone in! Anthony Golic puts a harmless-looking ball towards a goal. Did Tommy Urich get the final touch?
I think I did got a little touch in it, yeah.
The rocker. And he climbed all over the back of...
I'll tell you what, they... Whatever's going to happen here, I'm not sure.
And
he's got a
red card.
Yeah, maybe that's a sign of frustration where they weren't expecting to be 1-0 down and they wanted that crucial away goal. This certainly gave us an advantage.
Vitor Saba. And that's pretty agricultural. I think it was Lee Gian kicked out of his opponent and he's off.
Red card Galen.
And Lippi's down.
Well, it's gone
out onto the field.
Well, it's gone
protesting and his son. They've lost it, Guangzhou Evergrande.
That's kind of comical, really, wasn't it? It was all a little bit of handbags there at the end.
Maybe when you win the World Cup, they tell you what you can and can't do from now on.
You can always say it's unacceptable, but you just realise how important these type of games are. You know, he was rattled.
Do you believe what you were saying here?
Yeah, look, it happened so quick, the two sending offs, and I didn't appreciate their coaches grabbing Vitor. You know, it just shows how important this game was. It's Champions League. It's a quarter final, and yeah, there's a lot at stake. And it showed with their reaction.
You can't run on the pitch. This is Asian Champions League game. It's a competitive game. You can't do that. Simple as that. And he deserves to be suspended for quite some time from the sideline.
I mean, the red cards and the lack of discipline from the coach. It showed. I mean, they're an amazing club, but it just showed that maybe they didn't have the mental strength that we had.
Like I said, wonderful performance in the second half. Wonderful for Australian football, but like you said as well, Adam, it's only halfway done.
That doesn't make sense, that 8 days after you get beaten by Adelaide City, you go and beat the biggest club in Asia.
I think from the outside, maybe it doesn't make sense, but internally for us, it did. We never doubted that we couldn't win that first leg. You know, their lack of discipline at the end may have helped because the two players that were suspended were stars for them. And so immediately that was an advantage for us.
We go over there now and we know we have a real chance now to go through, and that's what we wanted after the first leg. It's half time, we've got a slight edge. We'll take that over there and we'll give it our all.
Then to China, and before the return leg, the game outside the game.
Yeah, the night before, the players were kept up through the night.
When they started banging on the door, Cover and I both thought something was up, and we thought about it and you could hear the abuse coming from the other side of the door.
Both of us were at the keyhole, yeah, looking out of it, yeah, waiting to see if he's going to come down the hallway.
And then an hour later, the phone rang and I answered, and there was nothing at first, and then a couple of guys screaming at me in Chinese, and I was like, oh, here we go. So I left the phone off the hook, and then the door again.
That's when I said, you know, I'm not going to sit here for another minute. I've had enough. I'm going to go try and find him.
So Cobber's stormed out. His bright fluoro pink undies screaming up and down the stairwell looking for someone.
I got to the exit and I saw the exit door was open with the stairwell going down. So that's obviously how he was getting up to our floor. We eventually got back to sleep, but the bus accident on the freeway was an absolute joke.
Yeah, we were expecting the worst, and fortunately we had two buses, no police escort. So that was, again, a concern.
I remember seeing the van that ended up hitting us leave at the same time from the hotel, so they must have been waiting for us there. And they were following us the whole way.
Kind of getting in front and dropping back and getting in front, and you do tell yourself he'll do something, but in the end you expect he won't.
Things sort of changed when he tried to swipe us once.
I thought, you know, I'm the only one that saw that. I was looking around to see if anyone saw it, but a lot of people saw it, so we're obviously on edge. Tried again and clipped the front of our bus in the highway.
Going 100 k's an hour, is, you know, 10 metres off a drop off the side of the lane that we were in. Our bus went, you know, straight into the back of him. Could have killed himself, could have killed everyone on the bus. But then a bus hit us behind.
The guy in front of us was more interested in taking photos of the bus than actually moving his car out of the way so we could go.
Yeah, we sat on the bus for about 10 minutes until the other one came, kind of laughing.
Yeah, we've got our staff moving the car, pushing it to the side. You know, you hear that these things happen, but you can't believe that you actually witnessed it yourself and went through it. But, you know, it just makes the story even better.
Elkerson, you seem to have a fun night with him. What a player.
Yeah, he's a good player. He's a good player. And at the time, I thought, that this is, you know, I don't know if I... don't know how much longer I want to do this for, but after the game, you know, the boys were giving me massive raps and I was like, maybe I actually did all right. When I went back and watched the game, I was like, for the most part, nullified one of the best players, if not the best player in Asia. I broke my arm maybe 10 minutes into that game. I remember at the time I could feel that. It was a lot of pain and something was up. Papa said, Shannon, you're right. I said, yeah, I think there's something wrong. I think it's... And he's like, you'll be all right, you'll be all right.
Oh, beautiful skills from Elkerson into the area. What's the tackle like?
He's given it.
Penalty given.
It's so unnecessary from Larocca.
Elkerson, Covic makes the save. It's a huge moment for the Wanderers.
For the team, I think it was a game changer. You know, that penalty goes in that first half and that's 1-0 to them, and the game's level and they can probably relax a little bit more.
Yeah, when I think of what they went through on the field, where they were fitness-wise, and that at half-time, there were players basically throwing up. They had nothing left. They were gone. And then to get that goal, you know, where they found the strength, where Bridget found the energy to actually make a 30-metre run to go in behind and win that penalty is beyond me. How Tommy was calm to put it away is beyond me.
Right into the bottom corner, unerring. The Wanderers have an away goal, 2-0 up on aggregate. Guangzhou now need three.
In a frantic final half hour, Lippi's men managed two. Two, of course, wasn't enough.
They've done it. Unbelievable. The Western Sydney Wanderers have beaten the defending champions Guangzhou Evergrande. They're through to take on FC Seoul in the last four.
Words can't describe this feeling that I have at the moment. I'm so proud of our team, our boys. You know, from everything we've been through today, what obstacles we've gone through, you know, to get past into the semi-final is just a massive achievement.
It's unbelievable, to be honest. We heard them getting the luggage and, you know, usually come home and we get in our cars and drive on home. But to hear that noise and to come home to this, it really shows where football is coming in this country.
How did you prepare and keep things on a level that they needed to be from quarterfinal to semi-final?
I think that's where the coach comes in, and he's got to be given a lot of credit to keeping us level, keeping us humble, keeping us hungry, and managing us physically and mentally. You know, he's been a big, or the factor, for us maintaining our competitive drive no matter what the result is. You know, you have to definitely pay credit to the man.
And the first leg of the semi-final against FC Seoul in Korea was exactly what Popovic was after. 0-0. No harm done. Despite the odd scare, it was advantage Wanderers for the second leg in Sydney.
Yeah, it was a very tough test for us, but, you know, a clean sheet away from home, I'll take that any day. The clubs in Asia aren't used to travelling 10 hours out to us, so, you know, in front of our home fans, you know, we'll take lots of confidence into the game.
Andy, how excited are you about this evening?
I'm absolutely psyched because it's one of the most important games in the history of football in the country, not just the A-League, but football in general. For us old fogies that have been around since the dinosaur era, we just want Australian success, and Wanderers represent that.
What does it mean if the Wanderers win tonight?
More than anything that you can imagine for the club and for these wonderful supporters and this multicultural community of support that they have. They've united the west of Sydney in a way that no other sport has. And it's just an unbelievable occasion tonight if they do it.
You always wish for a great start in terms of a goal, and you know, it couldn't have been better for us, you know, scoring so early, which now they needed that goal.
And it's in for the Wanderers! Mateo Poliak, a goal inside 3 minutes.
And I hear that you haven't trained all week because you've been recovering from the chickenpox. I can still see that you've got dots on you now.
Yeah, like so first day when we got back from Korea, I got him and I was like going day by day, and actually I was lucky with help of doctors and staff, recovered pretty well, and I think, yeah, good.
Shannon's goal, do you recall it?
I do.
The first leg against Guangzhou at home, Labby played a great ball to the back post and I stuffed it up. I had flicked my header and went well wide leading into the Seoul game. We're doing cross training. Labby sent a similar ball, and I've done the same thing. And I hit the post, but I did the wrong technique. And the ball skimmed off my nose and ripped a bunch of skin off my nose. And Ron Corrie came over and had a go at me. So, Shane, you've done the same thing as the Guangzhou. You know, head through the ball, head it back across goal.
And the header! Is that the goal from Shannon Cole that puts the Western Sydney Wanderers into the Asian Champions League final?
It wasn't much time to think. I guess it was just good that I went through that that mistake a few weeks earlier and learned from it.
And the celebration.
I was actually thinking that I was the only one that saw it live because no one was giving it to him on the field.
You look like you may have not perfected a 10 out of 10 landing.
Yeah, it's a bit stupid.
The one thing they told me not to do is to land straight on the flat wrist. So halfway through, pulled it out. Yeah, the boys gave me plenty of stick. And I mean, people still sending me pictures of it now, but who cares?
And the fairy tale run continues for the Western Sydney Wanderers. They're through to the Asian Champions League final, the first Aussie side to do it since Adelaide United in 2008.
We're here to win the final.
We knew as players that this is a moment that doesn't come around too often.
And they're in front, the Wanderers!
70,000 men screaming for our blood.
And now Broxton, it is three. Tony Popovic loses on the opening weekend for the first time.
Back-to-back derby wins for Sydney FC for the first time as the Wanderers suffer three straight losses in the A-League for the very first time.
It's not about fixing, it's just about getting the boys ready for you know, the biggest game of their lives.
With that in mind, a horrid start to the A-League was not an ideal situation. The salary cap effect, having to bring in new players, had an effect. A foreign notion to their oil-rich final opponents, Al Hilal of Saudi Arabia.
They're owned by the Saudi royal family, and the president, which is Prince Abdullah bin Musaid, is actually one of the wealthiest men in the world, and his family controls about 18% of the world's oil trade. So money is no problem.
We accept our limitations, but we don't use that as an excuse. We, regardless of who played or who we played against, we never prepared for a game believing, OK, let's try and get a draw out of this game because they have better finances, they have so-called better players. We went into every game believing we would win, and that's the approach we had from the outset.
We've always played big teams with big experience and big players. They were not satisfied with just getting to the round of 16. They wanted more. Same as a quarterfinal, same as a semi. So although I'm extremely proud of the group, we're here to win the final.
Winning is the only option. It's almost like a divine right. They believe that they are the best team in Asia. There's a lot of respect for what the Wanderers have done, but they feel that they're not even in the same league and that Al Hilal should go out there and claim what rightly is theirs, and that's the championship.
You played in A-League Grand Finals. How is the build-up to something like this at this stadium, your fans?
The A-League Grand Final is great, but this is the Champions League. I mean, it's named the Champions League for a reason, because the best in Asia compete for the one cup.
We knew as players that this is a moment that doesn't come around too often. If you don't take advantage of it now, you'll, you know, look back and regret it down the track. And we played a very good side that night. They were very good.
Physically, it was a very, very demanding game. I was playing as a winger that game, but it just felt like I was playing as a defender for most of the game.
And now Al Shamrani, and they dodge another ball at the Wanderers.
That's their best chance.
Clearly, they're a great side. You know, we're not going to say that we dominated them with our football. I mean, but I think we were strong. We were steely. We didn't panic. I thought that they would physically let up, and they did. And you know, that led to our goal.
Wanderers fans wanted to quickly move on to Juric.
It was probably, from what I remember, the best chance, but fantastic goal.
Larocca, Aliti, now Golic, early balls, tasty. Here comes Juric.
Yeah, it was probably the first real good bit of play that we had. And Tommy came on in this game and he really changed it for us. You know, he was strong, he was powerful, he caused them problems. And it was a very well worked goal.
To get your technique right in such a massive moment, it just proves that you're a quality player on the big stage, because I don't know if everyone could do that.
Oh, Juric, pass big out. No support, but Tommy Juric gets the head down and places it. And here's Bridge on the follow-up with a wooden break for him.
Ante Covic, he kind of gave a little inkling to what was to come in the second leg and the first leg.
He was safe as houses. I mean, he was so solid. He stepped up when we needed him to be.
He's through here. Aldosari. Covic stands tall again for the Wanderers, denying the away goal. Still got to stay alive, though. Covic again. Remarkable.
You preempted a little situation with Al Shamrani in the second leg. You had a little bit of a tussle with him.
Yeah, I think you could see early on that he was kind of a character that gets upset quite easily.
And a little bit of afters again with Covic. They don't get on.
Things weren't going the way he had obviously planned, and he was obviously getting frustrated that he's not putting the ball in the back of the net. And, you know, he had a couple of jabs at me, and you know, I had a bit of a giggle in his face, and I could see that he was extremely frustrated. And you know, I enjoyed that little battle with him, and he's a good foot shorter than me, so I wasn't too worried about what he could do to me.
Thiago Neves right into the wall. That's and there right. Goes the full-time whistle. Job done so far. There's fist pumps from the Western Sydney Wanderers. They keep a clean sheet and they take a lead to Riyadh.
and they all go and congratulate and thank Ante Covic.
We don't have any problems. We play a very good game. I'm sure after 6 days, when you play the next game, my team is going to win.
What was the build-up like over there? Say, compare it to the Guangzhou match in terms of preparation, any distractions or anything like that?
It wasn't as distracting, but you got the feeling that they thought it was a matter of course that they were going to win the cup. I mean, you could see with the coach's comments that he promised them, the fans, a win. You know, he called us a small club. They thought that we were going to be a pushover.
He has his way of working and, you know, whatever his motivation is, it is. I've never been one to really worry about what anyone's got to say. But when it comes to my team, I know the belief they have, and I won't be shy to speak positively about my side.
We're here because we deserve to be here. And the players are here because they're in the top two teams in the ACL. We showed in the first leg why we're a very good team, and now we need to do it one more time.
That crowd is the best. I mean, when you've got people saying, yeah, I've been to the Bernabeu, doesn't compare. The only thing I've seen close to that, Galatasaray, like, that's a big, big club. People talk about Guangzhou being the biggest club in Asia. I think Al Hilal would, you know, they'd beg to differ.
Maybe I feel I didn't really soak up the atmosphere of the two grand finals, but this one actually, before the game, stood out there for a while, and that's probably the most intimidating pre-game atmosphere that I've felt since, well, what I've experienced, Uruguay away in the World Cup qualifier.
When we walked out for the keeper warm-up, you just knew that there's no reason almost to yell and shout because no one's going to hear you on that field. It was that loud.
Adam Waterson was a yard away from us and you couldn't hear a thing he was saying. He had to act out every warm-up movement because there was just no verbal communication possible.
It was crazy. It was 70,000 men screaming for our blood. And it gives me tingles now thinking about it.
What an atmosphere. What an occasion for Australian football to be part of.
Their fans, as we ran out to start the game after the handshakes and all that, raised the big banners. Each banner would have covered Parramatta Stadium completely. Like, it was a different level. And we even, a few of us looked at the banners and looked at each other and was like, phew, have a go at these things. Like,
Western Sydney in Saudi Arabia to take on Al Hilal at a jam-packed King Fahd Stadium in Riyadh.
This was just about a result. How do we get a result? But, you know, throughout the week, I'd say we worked 80% on us with the ball and about 20% without it. But when you're playing this type of opposition, who are very, very good, with them on top, you haven't got the ball. You know, the natural instinct for the players is to try and hold on to something they have.
It was just, again, a lot of defending, a lot of sticking together and a bit of luck.
Referee there, you might notice, Yuichi Nishimura from Japan. He refereed the opening game of the World Cup, Croatia-Brazil, back in June.
Dodgy penalty,
yeah, thumbs up. He's relaxed, so that's a good sign. He is a very good referee, though, so hopefully there'll be no theatrics.
It wasn't that night.
Remember you telling me after the derby, I'm waiting for my luck. Is it fair to say you kind of got it?
Yeah, it is. It is. I mean, I'm glad that, you know, if it turned for us on that day, that it turned in the biggest game possible. So, yeah, there are no regrets with me on that one.
With the three decisions which went your way, how many of them would you look at and go, well, that was us, I'd be blowing up that we didn't get that decision?
Yeah, I mean, you could say that about all of them. The Golic one, I assume you're talking about three, it was possibly four. But the Golic one right at the end of half-time.
We had a wide free kick and, you know, for them to put the ball down, take a goal kick and within 3 seconds we're outnumbered, that was disappointing for me because we switched off and, you know, we're fortunate to get away with that.
OK, maybe it could have been given, but I don't think that one's a big deal if it wouldn't have been such a big talking point.
I remember speaking at halftime to the boys that, all right, we've had our good decisions here. I think we can't afford to give any away. And it must have been the first few minutes of the second half, Santa had a clear handball.
A one-hand ball again.
And I thought, that's it. you know, I'd look down away in disgust because I thought that's the straw that broke the camel's back, you know, that's it, but he didn't give it.
I mean, if it was the other way, you know, I'd be up in arms looking for a pen.
You know, I could go back to the group stages where we watched Al Hilal. They were very lucky to get through. Maybe in this game we were a little lucky, but over the course of 14 matches, you need a bit of luck.
The one that I expected to be given was when Kova came out.
Here comes Al Faraj again. Kovic comes. What's the call this time? Goal kick. That's extraordinary.
Just between friends, it was a pen, wasn't it? Maybe.
Yeah, look, when I first went down, I felt his foot brush across me, but I thought he made the most of it because he wasn't that much of a contact. I think on the TV, it looks worse than it was. Like at the time, I didn't really think there was much in it. You know, a bit of luck going our way, so be it.
Here come Al Hilal, though. Al Faraj and Covic again.
Your greatest ever performance?
If there was a better one, I can't remember it. I am a humble guy and I don't like speaking about myself too much, but, you know, I think I did change the face of those two games. I think I played a huge part in it and, you know, none better than the 85th minute that save that I will never forget.
And the Wanderers still in front on aggregate.
I think I was the closest player to him on the pitch.
I was running back in that position because I got beaten. And I remember the wall being squared and I thought, this is the moment where it goes in.
Yeah, it was just one of those moments. You know, with Ronnie, we work a lot on cutbacks and how to react to them. And it was just one of those things where, you know, I had to turn around and just go.
Al Shalhoub, here goes Al Shirani, Al Qatani, Covic with the save. It's an extraordinary save from Ante Covic. They can't find a way past the 39-year-old keeper.
Well, you thought that was it.
Those type of saves where the ball's behind you, sometimes it's so easy to have, you know, a touch and you lose your wrist and it trickles into the back of the net. But when it hit that hand, I didn't know if it was enough. And when I saw it walk past that post, I remember that feeling was, one of the best I've had in football.
This is a save that actually won in the game. And I always say to you, Adam, about big games, men and moments. This is the man, Ante Covic, and this was the moment.
I said to him after, because obviously you get a bit emotional after a thing like that, but I was like, mate, it's an honour just to have been on the pitch with you when that happened, because that's never going to be forgotten.
I don't know if I could say that was my best save, but in that moment, I'd say that was the best moment of my career.
I mean, after that save, I felt we're invincible. They couldn't even score. They're unmissable.
We could give them open goals here, and they're just not going to score.
The one shot that I'll always remember after that save as well is the reaction from their coach. Yeah, that was a good feeling.
Little touch off goal, and they are the history makers.
They've done it.
The Western Sydney Wanderers, champions of Asia.
I actually haven't seen this reaction from the players, but, you know, what a moment for them.
I dropped on my back and just started bawling, just overcome with emotion and how massive it was.
I was a champion for the first time in my eyes, and I truly didn't know if that, you know, if I didn't come through that one, where my next opportunity will be or if it'll ever come.
In just their third year of existence, they become the first Australian club side to win the Asian Champions League.
Thought of how hard it was for me personally to become a professional, just to play in the A-League. And now, as an A-League player, I've won the biggest trophy that exists in our part of the world. And I'm doing well not to tear up now, because it was, yeah. My whole football journey just rushed to my mind in that moment.
It was difficult. They're a very good team. But I said yesterday, we're an excellent team. And we showed over two legs how good we are.
Not that some of the opposition could cop that. Namely, petulant striker Nasser Al-Shamrani.
Yeah, obviously, they're scenes that you never want to see. And that's as low as it gets for me.
One of the staff, I don't know his role, after the home leg, he came up to me and said, don't worry, when you come to our home, we will. And I went looking for it, but when I saw him, I was like, nah, I'll just, come on, you know, be a good winner. So I went over and tried to be gracious and said, unlucky, you know, great campaign. And he said, no, gave it to me again. was like, all right, buddy. Remember what you said to me last week? You told me, yeah, guess what? We just came to your home and that happened to you.
We'll be seeing this shot for a long, long time. The Western Sydney Wanderers, champions of Asia in 2014.
We were called the small club yesterday. Today we are the biggest in Asia. That's the reality.
And an Australian club side has finally reached the pinnacle on the continent.
We could hear him from inside and we'd kind of been told, you know, this half of the airport's been blocked off, it's just for you guys. So everyone was a bit giddy and, you know, all excited.
Wow, this is, you've got to remember, this is at midnight. You know, this is a school night, a working night.
You just realise how big a moment it is, not just for the players on the field, but for everyone involved in this club, just what that meant for, you know, your average person who works, you know, 6 days a week. It was a proud moment for them, and it was a proud moment for us to walk out and present the trophy to them, because they've been through the journey with us.
First time in the competition, to win it, I think in the future we'll really understand how special this run has been and how it was to win this title.
Simple finish.
It's not until you sit down and you realise who we had to beat to get there, what you actually achieved.
Well, this is one of those nights when you can say you were there.
As a coach, I'm sure one day the time will come where you look back and say that was something special, but it's not now.
And they're in front, the Wanderers!
And to be called an Asian champion, you know, it's and the first Aussies to do that.
If you wanted to win this trophy up until now, you'd have to leave and go play for one of the biggest clubs in Asia. But a bunch of Aussie boys did this with the help of some foreign boys that came here to win the biggest trophy. That's my favourite part about this story.
This has been a production of Fox Sports.